from Acts 14, verse 21 to 28. And the title of the reading is Church Hurt. After they had preached the gospel in that town and made many disciples, they returned to Lystra, to Iconium, and to Antioch, strengthening the disciples by encouraging them to continue in the faith and by telling them, it is necessary to go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. When they had appointed elders for them in every church and prayed with fasting, they committed them to the Lord in whom they had believed. They passed through Pisidia and came to Pamphylia. After they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Attalia. From there, they sailed back to Antioch, where they had been commended to the grace of God for the work they had now completed. After they arrived and gathered the church together, they reported everything God had done with them, and that he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. And they had spent a considerable time with the disciples. This is the word of God.
Fam, I'm really excited to open up the Word of God with you. Look, whenever I do communion, I just always feel like it's ill-fitting to say, good morning, fam, my name is Reino, I have one of the privileges of serving as church's pastor and then serving communion. So, if we have not met and you don't know who I am, my name is Reino, and I have the privilege of serving this church's pastor. I also have the privilege of opening up the Word of God with you this morning. It's been an awesome morning. We were well led in all the movements of our service. I love communion. Worship was epic. There's a moment every single Sunday when we worship together when I start hearing the voices actually rise above the sound of the band. And then I go, absolutely love this. We could have gone for hours, you know. It was a great morning. Before we open up the Bible, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we have praised you. We've sung about who you are. We've sung about what you've done. Our minds and our hearts are full with you. You are present among us through your Holy Spirit. You speak to us through your word. So I pray that you would do that now, and that the Holy Spirit will illuminate our hearts and our minds, that your Spirit will confirm us in our identity, that we'll hear the good news again clearly, that we will learn what it is that you want from us in this day and in this time. Speak to us, Lord Jesus. We are listening. We pray that in your name. Amen. So fam, we've reached the end of the first missionary journey in the Bible. The first missionary journey in the book of Acts. Let me just remind you. In Acts chapter 13 verse 3, you'll see it up on the screen. It says, then after they had fasted, prayed and laid hands on them, they sent them off. All right, that was Paul and Barnabas. And part of the teaching text that Anesu read now was 14:26. And then it says, from there they sailed back to Antioch, where they had been commended to the grace of God for the work they had now completed. Okay? So we are finishing a trip that Paul and Barnabas took. Let me show you a map of the trip, just to remind you, because this trip spans over two chapters. They had 15 stops in total, if you count the start and finish that they had in Antioch. Okay, so if you follow the map here with me, this is where it all started, in Antioch. So they went Antioch, Seleucia, Salamis, Paphos. Paphos, Perga, and then from Perga, they went to Pisidian Antioch, then they went Iconium, Lystra, Derbe, and then Derbe, Lystra, Iconium, Antioch, Attalia, and then they crossed the sea again. Just to make sure that you know where we are, this is Israel. That's the Jordan River, the Sea of Galilee, and the Dead Sea. This is Syria, and this is the Mediterranean Sea. This is modern-day Turkey, and this is modern-day Greece. These two gentlemen, it's difficult to determine just how long they were away from home, but they were probably away from home for more than a year. Can you imagine the amount of stories you have? If you come back after a year and you didn't have WhatsApp video to update people, I mean, the amount of stories must have been epic. Now, as we followed the story, specifically through chapter 13 last week, we saw a lot of things. And I just want to remind you of it. In the beginning of last week's sermon, I actually started at Acts chapter 1, verse 1. And I just recapped all of it, all the way through to Acts chapter 13, 3. Okay, so if you missed it, I do want to encourage you to go and catch up. Let me just remind you, all through the book of Acts, and specifically on this first missionary journey, and specifically in chapter 13 that we saw last week, we saw that the Holy Spirit plays a massive role in the church and in the empowering of the church and its missionaries in their calling. Okay, so it's all about the Spirit. Secondly, we saw that the church sends out people. This is important for us to know about the church. And sometimes the church sends out unlikely people. You'll remember this team that we're currently looking at is Barnabas, the most huggable guy around, and Saul the murderer. Yeah, why don't we put these two guys together and send them away on mission? Obviously, there was a change of heart in the story of Saul, who then became Paul. You should also go and read Acts just to catch up on that. We saw last week that people get mixed responses to the word. That's also important. So you herald the word, you proclaim the good news, you tell people about Jesus, and not everyone reacts in exactly the same way. We saw last week that opposition is inevitable. And opposition is inevitable, fam, because we are currently in a war. The kingdom of God is against the kingdom of darkness, or the kingdom of darkness is against the kingdom of God. The kingdom of darkness will not sit back and see people come to faith on the basis of believing in the good news of Jesus Christ and just allowing it to happen. It doesn't work that way. There's a massive war going on. The kingdom of God is advancing, but as the kingdom of God is advancing, it's pushing back the kingdom of darkness, and then the kingdom of darkness reacts. So we should expect opposition as we share the good news and as we are in mission. We also saw that there's a big likelihood of relational conflicts in ministry and in the church. You know, in Acts chapter 6, there's conflict in the church about who gets what. In Acts chapter 13, there's conflict between Paul and Barnabas about John Mark. These things happen. We are people. We should expect it. It's likely that we will enter into relational conflicts at some point in the church. We saw that they had some physical challenges in making the gospel known. Why? Because you have to move your body and actually open up your mouth to preach the gospel. And sometimes moving your body over mountains and through valleys and through different seasons, literally, you are faced with real challenges. That's what these gents faced on their first missionary journey. We also saw from them, and I think this was an important point from last week, that making the gospel known in a way that is suitable for different audiences is also really important in the church's mission. You'll remember last week I said Paul started with what they had in common and with what they already knew. And he was like, hey, if they believe in the Old Testament and I believe in the Old Testament, why don't we start with the Old Testament? And then I'll talk about Jesus from the basis of the Old Testament. You'll see now in chapter 14, not part of our teaching text, that Paul speaks to a crowd of people that can't read. They also know nothing about the Old Testament. So then Paul goes, what can they see and what can I see? Ooh, they can see creation and I can see creation. So let's start there. Let's start with how good creation is and the God who created everything. And then I'll talk about Jesus from that point of view. Today we'll see, so I just want to add one thing. Today we'll see that perseverance and celebration is part of the story of the church's mission. Perseverance and celebration. Just to make it alliterate nicely with H's, I went for hardships and hoorays. And I also hoped with the weird hard rolling R that I have, hardships and hoorays will stick with you. It's part of the story of the mission of the church. Now, can I remind you, we have a triangle. This is our discipleship journey at Fellowship City. And we say a disciple loves God and loves people. A disciple knows God, commits faithfully, and gives generously. And then we describe how this disciple knows God, commits faithfully, and gives generously. And one thing we say is a disciple commits faithfully to the mission of the church. So that's why this whole sermon and this whole sermon series and this book in the Bible that we're currently studying actually matters. Because part of our discipleship, part of our transformation, part of the work that Jesus does inside of us is to have us faithfully committed to the mission of the church. Fellowship City is a small C church, right? A local church, but part of the big C church, and that is the global body of Christ. Part of our discipleship is being faithfully committed to the mission. Okay, now, why is this story important to us then to study today? Let me give you three quick ones. Firstly, the mission hasn't changed. Do you guys realize that? What the early church was busy with in the book of Acts, the church today is still busy with. Same mission. It's spelled out in the Bible for us. Secondly, this matters because the mission isn't finished. Jesus said that the Father will decide when the mission is finished. That is when everyone has heard the good news, and then He will come back. Until then, same mission, get going. And thirdly, ooh, and I love this one. This matters to us because the mission can't fail. Do you guys realize that? We are part of something that cannot fail. We are guaranteed a win. It is going to end awesome. The Bible describes the end to us. That means that we can play wholeheartedly and we can trust Him for the result. Isn't that great? I mean, think of so many other things that we are busy with each day. We, in a certain way, determine the outcome, you know, of our own finances and how we raise our kids and all of our KPAs at work and all that kind of stuff. This thing, we don't determine. The outcome has been determined and it can't fail. And that gives me great joy. So we are busy with church, we want to plant more churches, and I know that we're going to win. Because the book says that we are going to win. So we are part of the continuation of this story. This is a story for us to follow. It's a story to live into. It's a story to be faithful to. It is a story that should shape the story that we are currently living. Let me ask it this way. Does your life look like this story? If I ask it personally, does my life look like this story? You guys might know that we are part of a church plant organization called Acts 29. Do you guys know that the book of Acts only has 28 chapters? That's where the name of the church planting organization comes from. Acts 29, the continuation of the story. Now on Monday, we had an Acts 29, let's call it partners cohort here in our hall. If you were on the socials, you would have seen the photos. And at this gathering, one of the gentlemen who spoke, his name is Adam Ramsey, he asked this question. And it's been working with me the whole week. Let me show you the question. Here it is. He says, where specifically, read it with me, has your prayer for risk embracing boldness drifted into a prayer for risk avoiding comfort? And he had me. I was in the sound booth. I was Rudolph for the day. And when he asked that question, I just put down my tools and I was like, whew. It's so easy to wish for risk avoiding comfort. Everything we get sold on a daily basis is about not taking risk, is about not being bold. It's about being comfortable. We are so easily lulled to sleep to think that if we have everything we need to be comfortable, then we'll be good. And then we start praying accordingly. Lord Jesus, sovereign Lord of everything, will you please give me everything I want and need? I would really love that. And will you please make it not that hard to actually get it? Because then when I have it, then I can watch Netflix and not worry about anything. Where specifically has your prayer for risk embracing boldness drifted into a prayer for risk avoiding comfort? Look at what Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3 verses 10 to 12. He says, but you have followed my teaching, conduct, purpose, faith, patience, love, and endurance, along with the persecutions and sufferings that came to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. We just read about them. What persecutions I endured, And yet the Lord rescued me from them all. In fact, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. If the brother Paul says to me today, have you followed my teaching, my conduct, my purpose, my faith, my patience, my love, and my endurance? And I say yes. And the brother asks me, so where's your persecutions and your sufferings? What will I say? So how do I do this? How do we do this? Well, I think if we follow the storyline at least of chapter 14, then we persevere through hardships and we celebrate hoorays. We persevere through hardships and we celebrate hoorays. And for that, we need to be willing to go through hardships. We need to intentionally seek hoorays. Do you even contemplate these two H's every single day? Lord, are you calling me to go through a specific hardship for you because I'm keen? And Lord, are you currently doing something in my life and in the lives of the people around me that I should celebrate? That's how we do it. Okay, so I've got six things for you. One question, six answers. Let's go. What do we need to live a life of hardships and hoorays? Six things. Courage. Reliance on the Lord. Sound judgment. Faithful and flexible evangelism. Perseverance through physical trials. And commitment to the local church. Are you with me? Let's start with courage. Acts chapter 14, verse 1. Here we go. In Iconium, they entered the Jewish synagogue as usual. Okay, hang on. Why does this matter? Because, fam, in chapter 13, the Jewish synagogue is where it got really tough for them. The Jewish synagogue is where they got hurt, where they got rejected, where their persecution started. And now we read in chapter 14 that they enter the Jewish synagogue yet again. Do you know what you need to be willing to do that? Courage. You need to be willing to go to a place where you have gotten hurt before for the sake of the gospel. And the reason why I'm saying this is I don't even think that all of us who love our own comforts are willing to go into a place where we previously got hurt for something else than the gospel. I mean, think about it. You approach the office and the boardroom where you know it got shaky the last time. Your stomach starts turning, heart rate goes up, palms are sweaty, knees weak, arms are heavy. No, I'm joking, joking. Thank you for picking that up. And then you don't even feel keen to go to this management meeting or this team meeting. And then you somehow avoid it. Or entering into a relationship where you previously got hurt, or going to a place where you previously got hurt. We specialize in avoiding these places. Paul and Barnabas go, for the sake of the gospel, we'll go back. It didn't go well the last time. On the contrary, I might still have marks on my body. But let's go. Not for us, not for each other, but for him. Courage. Think about the Springboks. They walk out of the dressing room. They carry the badge. And they are filled with courage because they're representing the badge. You guys have heard this so many times as a chorus from everyone in the Springbok squad. We do this for South Africa. So they muster up the courage to face the toughest of opposition. We should too. For him. So courage, that's the first thing. Do you know where you get it? You ask God for it. And then you allow His Holy Spirit to fill you and to make you courageous. Lord, grant us courage. Second one, I love this. Reliance on the Lord needed for hardships and hoorays. Look at chapter 14, verse 3. I've got a highlight on there for you. So they stayed there a long time and spoke boldly for the Lord, who testified to the message of His grace. Look at the second highlight. By enabling them to do signs and wonders. You rely on the Lord to give you what is needed while you are on mission. You do your part, he does his, because he called you to it. In his sovereign wisdom, he decided to use humans, you know. He decided to bring the church into being. He decided that this is going to be the way that his mission is furthered. So then you say, okay, coach, I'm in. Now give me what I need. What do you rely on the Lord for? We spoke about it at our prayer ministry gathering this morning. If you did not pray in a day, it means that you didn't need God for anything. It means that you are prideful. It means that you think that you're okay on your own. And we so often fall into that trap. Lord, I just want to tell you, today is going to be my day. You can switch on your out-of-office responder. Take the day off. I don't need you for anything. These people knew what it was like to rely on God. They went to this really tough place. They stayed there a very long time. They spoke boldly. And then they said, well, Lord, we are trusting you to do the rest. I heard this awesome story of the late Dallas Willard one evening. He spoke in South Africa at a conference. And the guy who took him back to his accommodation, wherever it was where he was sleeping, said, so how was tonight for you? And he said, no, it was good. And then he said, are you curious to know what the people thought? And then Dallas Willard said, no, I'm not. And then he said, oh, why not? And Dallas said, because I'm trusting God to do something in the lives of the people through this message that I brought. And he'll do his part because I did mine. It doesn't mean that he wasn't open for feedback. It was just, he was completely trusting on the Lord that he'll do through him what it is that he wanted to do through him. Love it! Great story. Relying on the Lord. You know, we can grow in this by relying on the Lord for small things. How about, will you please help me with the right words in this next conversation? How about, will you please speak to me today and tell me to do something for you because I want to learn how to be obedient? How about, I'm going to pray before I plan my calendar because I need my time to mirror your mission in my life. Small movements. So that when you pitch in a city that you don't know and you go to people who might end up hating you and beating you, then you can say, Lord, I'm here in this position, now you do the rest. They were relying on the Lord. All of us rely on the Lord as individuals, and we rely on the Lord as leadership of this church, and we rely on the Lord as the church for Jesus to complete his mission through us. Reliance on the Lord. Third one, sound judgment. Look at Acts chapter 14, verses 5 to 6. It says, when an attempt was made by both the Gentiles and Jews with their rulers to mistreat and stone them, they found out about it and fled. So previously they stayed. This time they fled. The two of them had sound judgment about what to do and when to do it. And in this circumstance, they didn't stay. They looked at each other and said, we are going to die in this place. We need to go. Cheers, fam, we're out. Even though they stayed for a long time and they spoke boldly and God enabled them to do what they needed to do, the response was so hectic that they decided to move on. Sound judgment. Is that something that you exhibit in your life? Is that something that you ask God for? That's also wisdom. But to know where to go and when to do it and how to go about it, and also to know when it is time to go or when it is time to not pursue. We need the Holy Spirit in all of these things as we are together on mission. But I want you to see that these two gentlemen who are worthy of following, who we look up to, came to a place where they said, we got a roll. Barnabas and Paul out. Back door, there they go. Put your hoodie on, let's go. Keep moving, keep moving, keep moving. But they had sound judgment to know. Okay, so we've spoken about courage. We've spoken about reliance on the Lord. We've spoken about sound judgment. On the next one, I'm going to spend a little bit more time on faithful and flexible evangelism. Faithful and flexible evangelism. Okay, so I just told you that they left. Now, in chapter 14, verse 8, they go to the Lycaonian towns of Lystra and Derbe, and there they continued preaching the gospel. Okay, so now all of a sudden they reach a town where there is not a synagogue where they can go to. There also aren't a lot of Jewish people who they can speak to. And they're also speaking to a crowd of people who are illiterate, who don't read. Okay, so in the first part of their missionary journey, they could go, you know that you've read the following in Moses? Let me tell you what it means. Do you remember Isaiah and Ezekiel? Let me tell you what that means. Do you remember in the prophet Hosea? And then people would nod. Now they all of a sudden reach a group of people who speak a different dialect than what they speak. They reach a group of people who are illiterate, of a lower social economic class. They are polytheistic, they believe in many gods doing many things, and they know nothing of the Old Testament. So now Paul and Barnabas goes, okay, where shall we start? Hey, they have eyes. They can see. So why don't we talk to them about what they see and what we see? And then we craft the sermon and the gospel from there. Now, they did a miracle. And after they did the miracle, this group of people actually thought that they were from the gods. Okay, so they reacted thinking, hey, the gods visited them. So they called Barnabas Zeus, and they called Paul Hermes. Yeah, Paul was called Hermes. They wanted to bring them offerings. They wanted to worship them. And then look at what verse 15 says. Paul goes, people, why are you doing these things? In South African vernacular, stop it. It's pretty much what he says. He says, we are people also, just like you. And we are proclaiming good news to you, that you turn from these worthless things, there's the word repent again, to the living God, who made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and everything in them. That's where he starts his sermon. He goes, hey, heaven? Earth, sea, everything in it. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah. Okay, now, one God created that. You can turn back to Him by this good news that I have for you. Let's go. And that's how Paul starts his proclamation. And look at his simple message. In past generations, he allowed all the nations to go their own way, although he did not leave himself without a witness. Since he did what is good by giving you rain from heaven and fruitful seasons and filling you with food and your hearts with joy. Paul says to them, listen, God has been good to you. You might not know it, but let me tell you that He has been good to you. And let me tell you how He has been good to you. He has filled your stomach with food. He has filled your heart with joy. He left people to worship whoever they want, but not anymore. He has now made a way for people to turn back to Him. Then verse 18 says, even though they said these things, they barely stopped the crowds from sacrificing to them. That's an interesting verse, isn't it? Because people tend to worship things that they actually see more passionately than the things that they cannot see. Think about it. The new Beamer that you want rolls in. You can see it. You can smell it. You might be able to touch it and run your fingers over those beautiful ergonomic lines. No, aerodynamic lines. I'm not sure which lines. I don't ever look at new Beamers, but you know what I mean. So people tend to worship what they can see. So now they're talking to this crowd going, whoa, fam, you've got it all wrong. Let me give you the good news. And the people go, yeah, that's fine, but the power stuff you just did, that's awesome. Do it again. That's why we have so many false teachers in this world. That's why we have pastors who stand like me with microphones on their face, earning gazillions of rands while exploiting and extorting people for money, and people keep on filling up their churches because they do stuff that people can see, and it's the stuff that people see that they worship rather than the one they cannot see. It's not new, you know. It was just like that in the book of Acts. If Paul would stand here right now, he would go, oh yeah, we also had those kind of people. It's part of the human condition. We serve a God who we cannot see in person, but we can see Him through all of creation. And that's where Paul is headed with his proclamation. Look at this cool quote from John Stott, just talking about how we share the good news. Here's what John Stott says. He says, "Wherever we begin, we shall end with Jesus Christ, who is Himself the good news, and who alone can fulfill all human aspirations." That's how we share the gospel. And Paul speaks to these people and talks about the goodness of God. If you don't know what to say to someone about your faith, tell them how good God is. It's a great place to start. Here's what happened to me on Thursday. So, Monday morning, went for a run, came down a street called Orion Avenue. I was listening to a sermon. I saw a guy stand on the sidewalk, dressed in sporty clothes, with a shopping basket full of tennis balls. Now, I recognized his face because I've seen him run in the area before. And he said something to the extent of, "Yeah, well done, you're looking good," to me. And I said something back, but I had a sermon in my ear and there were cars passing us. So I couldn't really hear what he said. And I just asked something like, "Are you also going for a run?" And he said no, but I said yes. It's confusion, you know. But I had to go home because I had to take the kids to school, so I couldn't stop. Thursday morning, the same happens. So I come down Orion, I just completed a really good tempo run, and I see him stand in his sporty clothes, same sidewalk, same shopping basket, same tennis balls. So today I have time, I have margin. So I stop. Beep, beep. I go, "Hey dude, sup?" He goes, "Yeah, sup." I introduce myself, he introduces himself, and I say to him, "I've seen you running in the area, but today I see the tennis balls. What is it that you do?" He goes, "No, I coach paddle down in Brooklyn. I'm just waiting for my lift to come and pick me up." "Okay, nice. What do you do?" "No, I'm a pastor of a church." "Yes, see, that's really nice. What church is it?" "And it's called Fellowship City. It's in Centurions." All right, so we get to know one another. And he says to me, "Dude, this morning in my quiet time, I remembered the first question of the Heidelberg Catechism that I confessed as a teenager in 1992. What is the only comfort in life and death? And the answer is that I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my Savior, Jesus Christ." Here we are, on the sidewalk, and he just shares that God is so good to him. And he says, and his words were, "Dude, what could be better?" He says, "I realized that this morning, is that I have comfort in life and in death. And that is that I belong, that I'm not my own, but I belong to Jesus Christ." So then we hugged out. I was all sweaty, he wasn't yet. And then I left. It was great. And then him and his lift passed me. "Cheers, man! Cheers!" So beautiful, like he ministered to me in that moment. It was so fresh coming out of his mouth. I can't wait to see him again. I now know where his lift picks him up. So I might see him again in this coming week. That was his testimony that morning. We said it this morning. Jesus suffered as a substitute for our salvation. And our response to that is to repent, is to turn. And the moment we turn back to Him, we receive His forgiveness. And we didn't pay for it. He did. There's a first time that you turn, but there's also a second and a third and a fourth time. Repentance is a way of life for us. And every single time we repent, we receive. And every single time we repent and receive, then we remember how good God has been to us. That's why we preach the gospel every single weekend. It never gets old. You should hear it again this morning. You came to the table. You saw the bread and the cup. You tasted it and you confessed that you can taste how much God loves you. If you are in this place and you're not a Christian, know that God loves you and He made a way for you. If you are in this place and you are a Christian, know that God loves you and He made a way back for you if you might have gone astray. There are so many different ways in which you can accept Jesus, or in which you can surrender your life to Christ, or in which you can come to faith, or in which you can get saved. You do it through prayer, you know. Praying is speaking to God, Christianity 101. And the way that you get saved is by praying and saying, Lord Jesus, I believe. And then you just say what you believe in. I believe that you died for my sin. And I believe that if I turn, I'll receive this forgiveness. And I believe that you did it all in my place. And I want to be part of your mission and I want to be part of your church. Then you can say whatever you want after that, you know. There's no set formula. But that's how easy it is. My prayer the evening I got saved sounded like this. Lord Jesus, I have made a mess of my life. I shall now give it all back to you. Take it. Amen. Snot, trane, ach, tears, sorry. That was my prayer. And it's been 19 and a half years since. Never looked back. Faithful and flexible evangelism will take you through hardships all the way through to hoorays. That's the fourth thing. Fifth one. Perseverance through physical trials. Okay, so look at Acts chapter 14, 19 to 20 with me. Some Jews came from Antioch. Now, this is the original Antioch. Okay, so some people were so angry at Paul and Barnabas for what they heard about the work that they were doing that they took leave. Bought a plane ticket, flew to where Paul and Barnabas is, and then went, oh, when we see them, we are going to give them a good old rollicking. How angry must you be to put in leave and pay money for a boat trip and then look for these people to go beat them up? That's seriously angry. That is seriously angry. So some Jews came from Antioch and Iconium, and when they won over the crowds, okay, so they were opposing Paul and Barnabas. They stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, thinking he was dead. First missionary journey. Have you ever been hit on the head hard enough that you've lost consciousness? It is a spine-chilling, goose-flesh-inducing feeling. It's so disorienting. And here Paul is, unconscious, drag him out, give him a kick or two, he's dead. And now everyone stands looking at him. And verse 20 says, after the disciples gathered around him, he got up and went into the town. Wipes face, wipes blood off nose, goes back. And then it says, the next day, he left with Barnabas for Derbe. Okay, so that didn't go well. Where shall we go next? Paul keeps going. Fam, that's hardcore. Look at what he says in 2 Corinthians 11, 25 to 28. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I received a stoning. This is the one we just read about. Three times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. On frequent journeys, I faced dangers. And look at him listing all the dangers. Dangers from rivers. Dangers from robbers. Dangers from my own people. Dangers from Gentiles, other people. Dangers in the city. Dangers in the wilderness. Dangers at sea. Dangers among false brothers. Toil and hardship. Many sleepless nights. Hunger and thirst, often without food, cold and without clothing. And then he says, I can actually go on. Not to mention other things. I also carry something else with me, and there is this daily pressure on me, my concern for all the churches. Can you imagine if Paul would be with us physically today? And he would say, sup, Reina. I would go, sup, Paul. He goes, Reina, how long have you been on mission? And I go, dude, I've been on mission now for 17 years. And he goes, awesome. Show me your marks. And then I go, oh, dude, no. Actually, I don't have any marks. And then Paul goes, okay, whoa. So you're not being beaten for the gospel. You're not spending time on the open sea. You never get shipwrecked. You don't face any dangers from the wilderness. You don't face any dangers from the city. You don't face any dangers from false brothers. You don't go sleepless. You don't go hungry. None of it. No, Paul, none of it. And then Paul asks the question, so what's stopping you? Just think about that. Because none of these things stop Paul. We are not even facing these things for our faith in South Africa. So what is stopping us? Or if Paul would just ask this question, so why are you not on mission? Think about it, Paul over here. Just asking, not being facetious, help me to understand that if you aren't facing anything that I faced, why are you keeping your mouth shut? Why are you not using all of this technology that you have for my glory? Why do you put on photos of yourself? Why don't you tell people about Jesus on this crazy platform that you're using? Are you telling me that you can holler at your uncle in Cape Town who's not a Christian over the telephone? Yes. Why don't you call him? Are you telling me that you can get in a car and turn the ignition and then petrol starts exploding and then you move from point A to point B without your feet? Yes. So why don't you go? Just imagine that scenario. So what is your answer? What is stopping you? And why not? What is stopping you? And why not? Last one. Commitment to the local church. Okay, so let's recap. Courage, reliance on the Lord, sound judgment, faithful and flexible evangelism, perseverance through physical trials. Last one. Commitment to the local church. This is important, fam. Listen to me. You are not on mission alone. Yes! Never! We are all on mission together. You might be in a relationship that is meant for evangelism on your own, but you're still not isolated. You are part of a bigger body and part of a bigger mission. We are all in this together. So let's read slowly through these highlights. After they had preached the gospel in that town and made many disciples, they returned to Lystra. Okay, whoa. Isn't that where Paul almost died? Yes. So why on earth go back? Because there are brothers and sisters there. Just think about that. They thought that I was dead, but I'm going to go back. This time I might do a Kurt Lee Arendser on them. I might sidestep the danger, but there are brothers and sisters there. And I want to know how they're doing. And I want to know if they're growing. And I want to see if they're okay. And I want to ask them if they have everything they need. He carries this concern. So he traces back his steps, Lystra, Iconium, and to Antioch. And look what he does. Strengthening the disciples by encouraging them to continue in the faith. And by telling them, it is necessary to go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. And then it says, when they had appointed elders for them in every church and prayed with fasting, they committed them to the Lord in whom they had believed. So Paul cares about the local church. He cares about the people in the local church. He cares about the structure of the local church. And he traces his steps back to make sure that they have what they need, because he's on mission with them and they are on mission with him. And then he circles all the way back. 24, they passed through Pisidia and came to Pamphylia. After they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Italia. I showed you the map earlier, that's on the coast. And from there, they sailed back to Antioch, where they had been commended to the grace of God for the work they had now completed. And after they had arrived and gathered the church together, they reported everything God had done with them, and that he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. And they spent a considerable time with the disciples. So not only do we care for each other, not only are we concerned for each other, not only should we make sure that everyone has what they need, we should also tell each other of the arrays. Fam, I pray and I desire and I wish for this church to be a testifying church. How awesome will it be when we get together and we have a cup of coffee, and after we've spoken about how beautiful the morning is, then we say, dude, I need to share a story with you. Something epic happened this week with my cousin. Or something epic happened with someone in our townhouse complex. Or something epic happened between my wife and I. Or something epic happened with my kid. I have a story to tell you and I need to share it with you because we are all in this together. Can you imagine how that trip must have been? All the people who had compassionate concern for Paul would have gone, dude, what happened to your face? And your chin? And your mouth? And your shoulders? Did you fight Dricus du Plessis? You know what I mean? And then the other more apostolically gifted folk would have gone, so give me the numbers. Where were you guys? How long were you there? And what happened there? And where are we going next? And are we going back? And shall we send more people there? What do we need? You know? And they spent a considerable amount of time there with the disciples. As the church is on mission, the church remains committed to the local church. They stay committed to the church that sent them. We stay committed to each other. And I want you to see that there's power and joy in sharing hoorays. Because as we share our hoorays with each other, together we will be more willing and intentional about going through hardships. These two things fuel each other. The more hoorays, the more willing we'll be for hardships. The more we endure through hardships, the more hoorays we'll have. The more we share our hoorays, the more we'll be on mission together through the hardships. Life on mission is a life about hardships and hoorays, and we get to be part of this beautiful mission. Amen. I want to give us time to digest what we heard. I want to give us time to attentively listen to the Holy Spirit and what it is that He wants to say to each of us now. And I want to give us time just to think about the things we spoke about. Maybe today, courage is the thing for you. Maybe you've really struggled to work up the courage to say yes and to obey Jesus. Then that's your prayer. Lord, make me brave. Maybe reliance on the Lord is the thing that struck a chord, is the thing that resonated with you. Maybe today you were exposed in terms of not relying on the Lord for anything ever. And maybe that's your call, is to start relying on Him, and not only for the small stuff, but also to accomplish His mission and His purposes for you, through you. Maybe sound judgment is the thing that the Spirit needs to give you and empower you in, to know what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. And maybe there's that one thing that you want to bring to God today, to say, well, if you gave it to Paul and Barnabas, you'll give it to me too. If you think about the gospel, we spoke about faithful and flexible evangelism. I think there are two responses there. On the one hand, Lord Jesus, I believe in the good news. Maybe I believe it again today. I believe it anew. Maybe that's your response. Another response about faithful and flexible evangelism would be to ask the Spirit to give you the words in all of your conversations so that you would know what to say and when to say it, and that He'll give you that gift to start with the things that are visible so that you can eventually persuade people around God's love for them. If you think about perseverance through physical trials, I told you that we don't bear physical marks anymore. But maybe we've been stopped by things that are really irrelevant, by things that don't matter, by things that take up all of our attention and time, by things that are not glorifying God. Maybe it's just good old fear. Maybe you are just afraid. And maybe your prayer today should be, well, Lord Jesus, I'm not going to make excuses anymore. I'm going to take the field, I'm going to put myself in that position, and I'm willing to go through whatever I need to go through. And lastly, if you think of the local church, maybe today you are just called to a deeper devotion to the church and a deeper commitment to the church. Maybe today you think of a hardship and you think of a hooray that you can actually share with the people here. Then open your mouth and share it. And let us be strengthened and let us be encouraged. So whatever it is that the Spirit is calling you to respond to, bring it to Him now. I'm going to pray for all of us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank You for the first missionary journey. We thank You for the church in Antioch that sent out Paul and Barnabas. We thank You for Paul and Barnabas. We thank You that we can learn together what it means to push through hardships and to celebrate Hoorays. Lord Jesus, we want to see your mission furthered through this church, Fellowship City, and in our individual lives. We want to see your kingdom come. We want to see people come to faith. We want to see people saved. And we need you, Holy Spirit. In the same way that you empowered the church in the New Testament, we need you to empower us. So please do so. Give us courage. Make us rely on you. Give us sound judgment. Help us to be faithful in our evangelism. Give us the wisdom to know how to be flexible in our evangelism. Give us the endurance to persevere through trials. Move all of the obstacles we have out of our way. And Lord Jesus, grow this church and its witness to the world. For your glory we pray. Amen.